From those around, I hear a cry. Oh God, my eyes are blind.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, which is a greeting of peace. Peace be unto you, the same greeting of all the messengers of God. And we are here trying to help you understand the most misunderstood way of life in the world today, Islam, which is not a new way of life brought by Muhammad. It's the same way of life that was taught by all the messengers of God, calling you to the submission of the one God, worshiping Him alone and not His creation. So you've already learned something, and you're going to continue to learn something. All we ask is that you have an open heart, an open mind, and be ready for our next guest and our next topic. We're going to be talking about death, some of the details, because this is an appointment that we all have, and we want to get ready, we want to know how to get ready, and we want to know what to expect. And there's nothing out there like Islam that clarifies and gives you these details. So sit tight, you don't want to go nowhere. We'll be right back on the Deen Show.
Deen, Allah, there's only one God, and Muhammad is His messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah. Allah, there's only one God, and Jesus was His messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah.
I don't know why I did that. Maybe it's just to break the ice. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Alaikum salam wa barakatuh.
How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
It's like I just saw you. So, all right, we're going to get straight down to the top. We're going to be talking about death. This is something serious. We don't want nobody to run and get scared now, but this is something serious. So we're happy enough that you tuned in and you come to learn about Islam and to learn about the way of life that God Almighty wants you to live by. And we're very excited that we have you, a person who has memorized the whole Quran, who knows the authentic traditions of the last and final messenger who sent to mankind.
To some extent.
So we don't have a car mechanic, teaching us this deen, this way of life.
Right.
You're a specialist. Right. And we want to talk about the details. And I think this just is another evidence, because Islam has evidence on top of evidence on top of evidence to prove to the sincere person that this is from the Creator. This is not man-made.
Right.
So talk to us about death, something that we have an appointment with. Talk to us about that moment of death.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wasalam ala Rasulullah. The moment of death, which everybody fears. And everybody that thinks about death brings some pain in the heart. And that's why most of the people, they ignore this fact and they want to live a life of being away from it and forgetfulness, so that they don't feel the misery. But whether we like it or not, whether we run away from it or not, we have to face it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. Say, O Muhammad, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that death that you are fleeing away from, he has to meet you. He is already set his way out, as if this is the case, and you're going diligently every day towards the last and final rest in this life, and death is coming your way. So some point you have to meet it. It might be right this second, it might be after a month, a year. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. That's why it's not just for those who are sick. Some people die in car accidents. Some people die just like that with a heart attack. Whatever, the means are many, many, many. But the one thing that is for sure, death is coming. So because of that, and because Allah is the most merciful, He mentioned the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, some very specific details, so that the believers would know exactly what they're going to face. Although saying it and hearing it is nothing compared to seeing it with one's eyes. So first of all, it would never bring misery, just to make this clear, because the one that brings the joy and the misery is the Creator of the heavens and the earth, and He's the one that made this place of happiness is in the heart. Mm-hmm. And the most happiest man that was present on the face of earth was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about him, "Alam nashrah laka sadrak," didn't we make your rest spacious, meaning that you're happy in this life, although He's the one that ordered us to remember death much. So if you remember death much and you are steadfast on the religion of Islam, you will be the most happiest person on this face of earth and in the hereafter. At the moment of death, the Prophet, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said in a very long and lengthy hadith, and I won't say the whole thing, yeah. but he said in this long hadith in details what can happen to the person. And he divided the people into believers mm-hmm. and disbelievers.
Yeah.
And he said, when the person is about to start his hereafter, because the hereafter starts with the moment of death, mm-hmm. and he's departing from this life, if he's a believer, the angels will come to him from the heavens and with bright faces, and they would sit with him as long as his eyes can see. And this is reality. This is more real than the fact that I'm sitting here and I'm looking at you and you're looking at me. So at that moment, he would see the angels sitting, lining up all the way to what his eyes can see. And then the angel of death, there is an angel responsible for taking the souls of the human being. The angel of death will come down and he would sit in front of him and he would order the soul. And he would say to the soul, to the believing soul, go out to the mercy and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the soul will come out, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, in the meaning of which, like a drop of water coming out from the opening of a water skin. See how easy and soft that happens? This is the soul of the believers come out in such an easy way. So once the soul comes out of the believer, the hadith says, again, this is not opinions, this is the sayings of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, revelation from Allah. Once the soul come out, the rest of the angels, they don't leave it in the hands of the angel of death. They would take it and they would wrap it in a coffin from Jannah, from paradise, that has the best fragrance and the best smell. And they would take it and they would go and elevate to the heavens with the soul. And every heaven that they would go to, sky and levels, we know that there's seven heavens or seven skies, they would take the permission and the angels would say, who is that person with the best names that he used to be called in this world? Why? Because of the great smell that they are smelling and the great thing that is happening. So they would say, it's so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, with the best names that he used to be named in this mm-hmm. world. And they go from one heaven to the other till they reach the seventh one. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say that, write the deeds of my slave in the highest level. And this is for the believers. And return his soul back to the earth, because I promised them that from the earth I created them, and from the earth they shall return, and from the earth they shall be resurrected. So the soul will come down into the body again in the earth, but not just in the same way that we are living now. And then after he is buried, then and people depart from his grave, and the Prophet ﷺ, he said that he would hear the footsteps of the people when they're departing, the dead person. Then after they leave, the angels of death, or two angels will come to him. And these two angels will make him sit in a way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We're not talking about physical things here. And they would ask him three questions. And this is what is very important for us to realize now, that this is what we prepare ourselves for. Do we have answers to these three questions or not? And the answers is not just what we know, is how our life was. They would ask him, who is your Lord? What is your religion? And who is the messenger that was sent to you? And the believers, they would say, when they asked, who is your Lord? He would say, Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth. And what is your religion? He would say, submission to the creator of the heavens and the earth, which is Islam. And who is your prophet? He would say, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That moment, he will be opened a gate in front of him to the hellfire. To the hellfire. And it will be said to him, this was supposed to be your place if you would have been a disbeliever. But it was replaced for you by another place, and then a gate to the paradise will be opened to him, and the fragrance and the goodness from the paradise will come into him, and it will be said to him that this is your place when the day of judgment would occur, but not now. So at that moment he would say, O Allah, make the hour occurs. He wants it to happen quickly so that I can go back to my family and my wealth, meaning to enter the paradise. And the total opposite is for the disbelievers. And let me just start it by, I know I'm taking too long,
no.
But for the disbelievers, the Prophet ﷺ gave the example that it would make it more closer into our minds. He said, when a disbeliever is about to die, the angels of punishment will come down unto him. And they are the most horrific looks, these angels, creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the angel of death, also they would sit in front of him as far as his eyes can see. The angel of death will come, and then he would say, ordering the soul to come out, and he would say, come out to the punishment and the anger of the creator of the heavens and the earth, because you had committed injustice against your own self when you did not fulfill the purpose of your life. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said at that moment the soul would scatter all over the body of this disbeliever.
Doesn't want to come out.
So what happens? The angel of death would snatch it, would pull it so hard that it would be so much, of course, painful. And the Prophet ﷺ gave the example that it as if it's tearing the person, tearing him, like you have a piece of iron in a wet wool. What happens to it? It just tears it apart.
Is that from being attached to this world and not having been prepared for the next life, like neglecting your obligations?
The state of forgetfulness and the state of disbelief.
Yeah.
And it becomes all over the place. It does not, see, remember the first example?
Mm-hmm.
It comes out like a drop from a water skin. Very easy and
you're
very
ready.
Soft. Right. But the disbeliever, he had to do this to it. And then when it comes out, the angels would wrap it in a coffin that is from the hellfire that has the worst smell to it.
Yeah.
And when it's tried to go up into the heavens, it won't be able to. And the angels for the first heaven, it would say, who is this nasty and bad smell?
Yeah.
Human beings, it would be said so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, with the worst names that he used to be named in this world. And then it would say, or something would be said, that bring him back to this earth, and it would be thrown into the earth again. And when the angels would come to the person after they depart, after they burying him, the two angels would come and make him sit and ask him the same three questions. Who is your Lord? That person would say, ha, ha. This is what the hadith says. Ha, ha, I do not know. I heard people saying things.
You didn't prepare.
He was not preparing himself.
Yeah.
He was busy with the sin and the disobedience of the creator of them. He heard people saying, come, worship the creator of the heavens and the earth alone. They advised him. They told him so many times. But he was busy with intoxicating himself. And he will be asked, what is your religion? He would say, ha, I do not know. I heard people saying things. Who is your messenger? He would still not able to answer. Although he might know it, but the tongue would only speak of what was present in the heart. And then it will be opened for him a gate to paradise, to Jannah. And it will be said to him that this was supposed to be your place if you were a believer. See how much regret a person would have when he sees this. And then a gate to the hellfire will be opened, and it will be said to him that this is your place. And all the bad things will come to him from the hellfire. And he would say, oh my Rabb, oh my Lord, do not make the hour occurs. Because now he knows that he's going to the punishment of Allah. And he has to live with this everlasting, without no end. Because of what? Because of few years that a person lived in a state of disbelief and forgetfulness. And let me just add something. Somebody might say, isn't that a form of injustice that a person lives 60, 70 years in state of disbelief and then he has to live everlasting life in the hellfire? You know, why is that much?
Yeah.
To answer this is, for someone that lived and died in the state of disbelief, he had the intentions while he was living that if he would live forever on the face of earth, he would live forever in the state of disbelief. So as a result of this attitude, that his punishment is an everlasting one. Allah is the most just. And he would not punish anyone unless the matter is made clear to him. And as Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا كُنَّ مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We do not punish till we send a messenger. This is the mercy of Allah. Messengers are being sent. And they send to tell you, oh you human being, you believe in God, worship Him alone. And then you turn away. You worship other than Him. You live a life of forgetfulness. You don't want to do nothing with being steadfast on the proper submission to the creator of the heavens and the earth, then do not blame no one but your own self. That's why it's such a serious matter. The early generations of Islam, they used to take this matter so serious that their whole life is just preparing themselves to this last moment of this life, because afterwards, anything that we did, we have to live with it everlasting.
So it's on you. Now that person, a Muslim might have a non-Muslim, his colleague at work, and they might be watching the show. So they might actually be a little more enthusiastic about doing what they need to do, the simple thing, to become someone who is a believer and the one who can answer those questions when death comes, when that appointment comes. So you're not like that person in class who didn't study and the teacher calls on you like, that. Right. No, you can ask, Allah is my Lord.
Right.
Islam is my way of life, and Muhammad is the last and final messenger. And you show it through your actions. Tell us right now how simple it is, so someone doesn't have to be out of the mercy of his creator. How simple is it? What does a person have to do to be on the side of the angels, when the angels come and give you those glad tidings of